Good morning. I'm your host, Dr. Vijila Kennedy, principal of Kumaraguru College of Liberal Arts and Science. I welcome you to the webinar series, Nation Building Through Civil Services, from August 10th to 13th, 2020, which aims to empower the future leaders of the nation through conversations with civil servants, policymakers, and change makers of the nation. The webinar series is hosted by Kumaraguru College of Liberal Arts and Science, Coimbatore, in partnership with Shankar IAS Academy, Chennai, and Takshashila Institutions, Bengaluru. All these three institutions excel in their domains and create a national impact. CLASS, Kumaraguru College of Liberal Arts and Science, offers the most unique liberal arts education, including degree program in political science, and has the Kumaraguru Civil Services Academy in partnership with Shankar IAS Academy. Shankar IAS Academy coaches and mentors in the recently declared UPSC CSE results. 201 students of Shankar IAS Academy cleared the exams. That is 25% of the total results declared. That's indeed a fantastic achievement, and our congratulations to Shankar IAS Academy. Takshashila Institution is an independent center for research and education in public policy, and they are the knowledge partners for this event. We are happy to present the first talk in this webinar series, Environment and Human Health, a New Perspective. To give a background and to set the setting of this talk, we will have an in-depth presentation on the topic for 1 hour, 30 minutes, followed by 20 minutes of Q&A. Please post your questions on the comment, and the session is live streamed in FB and YouTube of Kumaraguru College of Liberal Arts and Science, and also the YouTube of Shankar IAS Academy. To talk on environment and human health, a new perspective, we have Dr. Sultan Ahmed Ismail, who's a renowned soil biologist and ecologist and has a DSc in zoology from the University of Madras. He is the managing director of EcoScience Research Foundation in Chennai. He has over 4 decades of academic experience in the departments of zoology and biotechnology. I could hear from his earlier conversation how passionate he was about teaching, being with students, and being with the children. He has done extensive work in ecology, sustainability, organic farming, and waste management. And we are very happy to share that he has received several awards for his extensive work. To name some, Commonwealth Association of Science, Mathematics, Technology Educators, CASME Award in UK, Arinyar Anna Award by the Department of Environment of Tamil Nadu Government, Award of Excellence by the Governor of Jharkhand, Special Contribution Award by the World Earthworm Industry Forum in China for his extensive work in the research in earthworms, and Champion of Chennai in 2019. So we are very happy that we have a champion here with us to talk to the various participants who have joined us here. He also holds a senior position in various academic and research committees of Tamil Nadu government and the Government of India. He has written a very popular book, The Earthworm Book, which has been translated in Tamil and in Chinese. He has also published more than 80 research articles, guided 20 PhD students and 32 MPhil students. So a very strong academician, a researcher, a person who is very passionate about making a change and making an impact in the world. We welcome you, sir, for this session. We welcome all the participants who have joined us through YouTube and Facebook, and I'm sure that we'll have a fantastic time of learning. Sit back, take notes of whatever is being shared, pose your questions, make the sessions interesting and useful for your learning. Thank you, and over to Dr. Sultan Ahmed Ismail for the talk.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Good morning to all of you, and it's a pleasure to be associated with our Kumaruguru College as well as Shankar's Academy, IAS Academy. It has always been my pleasure to be associated with Shankar's IAS Academy for past several years, and I'm happy that Chandrasekhar Chandru, whom we affectionately call him as Chandru, is also present today. I would like to take you through a journey on ecology. So sit back, relax, as ma'am told you, and points remember in your mind. That's more important for us. I just want to take you through this journey, a very simple, basic journey on environment and human health. One more thing I would like to tell all the participants over here and some of the teachers who are also participating, that when we prepare a PowerPoint, we should be clear as to how we make a PowerPoint. Of course, I don't use PowerPoint as PowerPoint. I use a presentation. I use Mac, so I use Keynote. I don't use PowerPoint, but it's almost the same. How we prepare it matters a lot. So dear teachers, my humble request to you is, because there's a new term called as death by PowerPoint. We have this bad habit of writing sentence after sentence and just reading them out. We have to change our presentations to make them acceptable by children, because the journey is moving towards lots of interactions which are going to be in the form of blended learning, where there are going to be physical classes as well as digital classes. I always believe that we learn only by a process of teaching. We don't learn by reading or doing, by teaching. Because when we teach, we learn a lot of new things. So learn to teach people. And teaching always takes us higher. That has been my experience. I would also like to quote that 2020, the theme for the World Environment Day has been Celebrate Biodiversity. Please remember this at the back of your mind as I go through the lectures. Celebrate Biodiversity. That is what the meaning tells. We all talk about climate change. We talk a lot. We tell climate changes, climate does this, climate does that. And then we talk about things like restoration. We always tell people, you know, like I can restore the lake. We know people who have claimed, especially NGOs who or the government offices, we say forest restoration. Somebody asked me about human behavior. One Mr. Dheeraj has already put a question over there, and environmental impacts. Now, we always tell, you know, like soil restoration, forest restoration, lake restoration. My simple analysis of the whole ecological system, because I have been teaching ecology for nearly 45 years now, is when a person meets with an accident and his leg is getting amputated, if he can give back his original leg, that is called as restoration. But we are unable to give an original leg, so we give an artificial leg, and that is rehabilitation. Any natural ecosystem, if it gets damaged, we can only rehabilitate. Human beings cannot restore nature. This, let us be very clear about it. Nature restores itself. See, whenever the forest is destroyed, people talk it as afforestation. But afforestation is not natural forestation. It is what we plant, the trees which we can plant so that they can grow faster. So rehabilitation is different from restoration. We rehabilitate by two ways. One is mitigation. In mitigation, what we do is that, fine, let me try to do this. For example, from today, I will not burn things. From today, I will not do this. From today, I will avoid using most of the plastics. The second one is adaptation. I just don't care. I just don't care. I don't mind however the world may change, but I'm ready to accept it. So there are two ways of approach to solve this problem. Having this in mind, that is our ecosystem. In our ecosystem, we have birds, butterflies, plants, animals, human beings all together, and three major components in our life. Children, especially those who are listening to me, please try to understand that right from the beginning, right from our school days, we have been given a concept which is quite contrary. We have been told about living and non-living as a basic concept. We have always been told that air is non-living. We have always been told that we are living. Nothing wrong. But nobody tells us that if we remove the non-living air from my body, I become non-living. Water is non-living, I am living. But remove the non-living water from my body, I become non-living. So the concept of relationship between living and non-living has not been emphasized right from school. So our way of teaching has to change at every level today to make children understand. And you people, once you become officers, to relate yourselves with what is around us to what we are. And along with this, we include two more systems and we call it as the Panchabhutas in our culture. Is that clear? So two major components in life. One, energy that flows from the sun. Energy that flows from the sun and nutrients which cycle in the environment. These are the two major concepts of ecology. And that is where I always like to use this example because I enjoy talking about this as to who eats more, an elephant eats more or a dog eats more. Now, normally, whenever we see students and like when you see a boy who is slightly obese, I used to be obese when I was in school. So people used to say, you know, like this fellow will eat more, and they would always make fun. Where do you buy rice from, right? But when you look at the body weight and what they eat, and when you compare with them, who eats more? The weight of an elephant is around 5,000 kg. The heaviest elephant recorded is about 8,000 kg. And the weight of a dog is around 20 kg, an ordinary dog which we meet happen to at home. If I'm going to feed the elephant, I may feed 50 kg of grass per day. And for a dog, maximum I can give is 1 kg of meat per day. Any food or medicine is always related with reference to body weight of the organism. So if a 5,000 kg body weight eats 50 kg, 1 kg body weight of elephant eats how much? When you refer it, it's just 10 grams. But when you look at a dog and see how much 1 kg of dog eats, it eats 50 grams. So he eats more. Dog eats more. Dog eats more than an elephant. Understand the concepts of ecology when we work with the environment. If you ask me why should it eat so, it eats because the elephant eats the grass which directly fixes the solar energy. Whereas a dog eats the meat of an animal which eats the grass which fixes the solar energy. So every trophic level, there is reduction in energy per quantum of food. That is why in India, we are vegetarians. I mean, I tell that many people will laugh at it as to we are also having non-vegetarians. Yes, we also have non-vegetarians. Please visit any restaurant and order for a non-vegetarian meal for those who are non-vegetarians. You order for a non-vegetarian meal, what do you get? You get rice, which is vegetarian. You get chapati or paratha or puri, which is a vegetarian. You get vegetable kootu, salad, which is vegetarian. You get sambar, you get rasam, you get all those things are vegetarian. You get curd, which is vegetarian. You get sweet, which is vegetarian. And then in a small bowl, you may get one or two pieces of meat or chicken or fish. We predominantly in India, we believe in vegetarianism is because of the energy flow mechanism that is involved. Traditionally, health systems have provided information about how energy gets transferred. That is most important. And all those students who are listening to me, my humble request is please understand these words, eco, E-C-O. You know, like, for example, when I send an SMS to a friend of mine, and if I want to write something in vernacular, like, for example, my North Indian friends who are wanting to send hum will write H-U-M. My South Indian friends who would write naan will write N-A-N. In the same way, O-I-K-O-S. Though most of the teachers also wrongly sometimes pronounce it as oikos, it is not oikos, it is echo. Originally pronounced as echo, it means home. Home. The same thing in English has been written as E-C-O. O-I-K-O-S has been written as E-C-O. Home. If I study the home, it is ecology. If I evaluate my home, it is economy. Nomi is numbers, logy is study. The problem today is there's a clash between these two. Between ecology and economy. And in this clash, something burns. And what burns is ecology. That is where we have to strike a balance. We talk about biodiversity. I told you that this particular 2020 has been declared as Celebrate Biodiversity. Please understand, children, what is theory, what we decide, and what we practice. Please have an understanding about these components. Bio means life. Diversity means variety. Diversity means variety. Fair enough. And in biodiversity and conservation, when you go into the details, biodiversity sustains the environments. It actually sustains, right? At the same time, it provides me with important things. Biodiversity provides me with food, with clothing, with medicine, with fuel. And it also sustains my ecosystem services. It gives me clean air. It gives me drinkable water. We, India, are rich in biodiversity. Please have this in mind. Please have this in mind that we are very rich in biodiversity. We have beautiful flowers. We have lovely birds. We have magnificent animals. And we have plenty of vegetables. And within each vegetable, we have several varieties. So you take tomato, you have several varieties of tomato. You take any vegetable for that matter, whether it is beans, whether it is avaraka, whether it is katrika, you have several varieties in them, right? All this is variety. This is biodiversity. This is biodiversity, children. All these belong to our country. You can read it for yourself. Some of you can even take a screen picture and keep it with you. The problem is what happened was when Westerners came over here, when Europeans came over here and settled in our country, they started calling our grains by different names. They called it as cowpea, pigeon pea, chickpea, horse gram. And gradually people felt that these are supposed to be eaten by animals, not by human beings. That is where we made a big mistake. You know, like horse gram is kuldu, kulthi, your kulth, right? Now, this has lots of protein in it. And today, horse gram extract is being sold in bottles, half a liter bottle, costing 450 rupees, good for our cholesterol control as a medicine. We have moved away from our own traditional food because we thought that this is not required by us. We had so many varieties, so many varieties of breeds of cattle, sheep, goats, camel, horses, and then the conflict came in. We started discussing between, this is our local cattle, Indian cattle. Indian cattle is called as Bos indicus. Of course, the new classification calls it as Bos taurus indicus. And then you have the Bos taurus taurus. Taurus is a zodiac sign which says the bull, right? In the foreign Western cattle, you don't have a hump. Whereas here, you have the hump. At the same time, this cheek, you know, like beneath the chin, you find this beautiful sort of a skin fold, which is absent in the case of foreign cows. So if you look at these animals, that's an Indian bull. Look at it very carefully. This is an Indian bull compared to a Western bull, Bos taurus. So when you look into the details of it, they see. And Gir is one of the most beautiful, beautiful cows. Of course, we have the Ongole. We have several other breeds of cattle down south. Senapati maintains a beautiful cattle farm. You have beautiful, beautiful such cattle of India. So this is our Desi. And if this is Desi, this becomes Paradesi. I hope my Tamil students would appreciate it, right? Now, so you have the difference between the Desi and the Paradesi cattle. And when all this was going on, suddenly, children, please understand, we are talking about what? Celebrate biodiversity. This is our biodiversity, right? And suddenly we have come into this. Please read this sentence carefully, which is in quotes. Beltsville sperm sexing technology. Sperm sexing technology. You know, like in the case of human beings or any mammal or including cattle, we all know that the male produces two types of sperms. It can be a X sperm or a Y sperm. Whereas the female always produces a X chromosome in its ovum. If a male sperm, that is the Y sperm from the male, fertilizes the X ovum, it produces a male calf. If the X chromosome of the sperm, X sperm, fertilizes the ovum, it produces a female calf. Suddenly people felt, why should we have so many bulls in this country or anywhere in the world? Bulls are useless. So why not completely segregate them? A new technology has come in where by passing through the technology, you can completely segregate X sperms away from the Y sperms. Now, Y sperms are the ones which are going to produce the males, so you destroy them. And only the X sperms can be put into some sort of straws. We call them as straws for artificial fertilization of cattle. So these X straws alone will be used for fertilization so that we get generations of female cattle. And India has also entered into this project. Now, what happens is the entire biodiversity will get affected because the biodiversity genes are carried in a gene pool by both the male and the female. Whereas from one bull, you're going to have so many straws prepared. That means the same genetic characters are going to be transferred and the minimum sort of bonding is going to take place in the gene pool. Today, they want to start with the cattle. Tomorrow, it can be for any animal. Similarly, when you go into poultry farming, look at the poultry farming. We started calling our own chicken as country chicken. Country chicken. We started calling our own chicken as country chicken. We have given a name to it. And we started calling this chicken as chicken. Now, when you start looking at the details of this chicken, please understand how ecology is getting affected, that this chicken are being bred with so much of hormones and antibiotics that in my younger days, in 70 days, the bird will stand in attention, but today stands in standard, is unable to bear its own weight. Now, this is because of lots of hormones. When you look at other biodiversity, that is our own aquatic fauna, when you look at the fish, especially those above Tamil Nadu, from Andhra onwards towards eastern regions and the central India, most of them prefer freshwater fish. So we have Katla, Rohu and Mrigal, which is very common. Most of you children know it. Most of you children know it. Whereas when you go into the marine world, these are the most popular fishes, especially pomfret and seer are supposed to be the very expensive fish. Whereas mackerel and sardines, which are favorably called as Ailai and Matti, most popular in the western, especially Kerala and some parts of Tamil Nadu and Maharashtra, or the Maharashtra coast, Karnataka coast. And these fishes are supposed to be the tastiest. But today when you go to a restaurant, we have this much of biodiversity. But when we go to a restaurant, most of the fish which is served to us is this fish. This is a catfish, cultured in fresh waters in Indonesia and Thailand. The skin is ripped off, the bones are removed, and the fillet, these are called as fillet, the pieces of flesh is called as fillet. And these fillet are chemically treated to make them look beautiful. And then they are packed up as an ice cube and sent to various parts. I live in Chennai, and in Chennai, this fish is available for about 250 rupees a kilo. Whereas our own fish is available for 500 to 600 rupees a kilo. And during the pandemic, it's around 800 to 1000 rupees a kilo. So what has happened is most of the restaurants buy this fish. And then they beautifully thaw it and then serve it to you in a beautiful platter. Now, I don't want you not to eat fish. Eat fish. But when you go to a restaurant, ask for a slice of fish which has a bone in it. Or the small fish which still has the bones in it. That is how we can protect our own biodiversity. Unless we encourage our own biodiversity and understand the concepts which go into it. For example, here, you see a bird taking nectar from the flower. At the same time, there is a bee which is asking for a lift from the bird to go to the next flower faster. Very simple mechanism. If I eliminate this bird, eliminating this bird means not one bird, but the species. If I eliminate that species, in the course of time, the plants which were catering the need of this bird also fade away because the bird was indirectly fertilizing them. The insects which are moving faster with the bird also vanish because they don't have enough transporting mechanisms. So what happens today, this bird is missing. Gradually, we will not be able to see plants associated with this bird and insects associated with this bird. This is called as plant-animal interaction. You see, when you look at a butterfly taking nectar from the flower, nothing new into it. Everybody knows about it. What is new into it? I happened to visit a college at the outskirts of Chennai, where they had not yet developed any flowering plants. I'm glad to know that Kumaraguru has a sustainable ecosystem over there. Now, when you don't find flowers, what do these butterflies drink? Fruit juice. Now, if this is going to continue, then in the course of time, squirrels will be eating lollipops. If I have to conserve my own biodiversity, what should I do? This is what some basic thoughts as an ecologist I would like to share with you children. Supposing I look at a tiger. A tiger, now our national animal, a pride, a beautiful pride. In fact, we call them as pride of lions and pride of tigers when they go in a group, right? Now, these tiger, for example, I take one tiger. A tiger goes, hunts a deer and eats the deer for manas after. So, supposing it eats a deer for 1 month, it may not require one more animal. Casual. Sometimes it may require, sometimes it may not require. Usually, they don't hunt for the sake of pleasure. They hunt for the sake of food. So, if I take at an average, one tiger has hunted one deer for 1 week as a rough calculation. One tiger, there's not one tiger, there are plenty of tigers in a forest. This one tiger may require at least 52 deers per year. If this particular person has to take 52 deers per year, there should be at least 520 deers in that forest so that one tiger can take 52 from them. If 520 deers have to survive, there should at least be 5,200 acres or hectares of land which grows fodder, which supports the deer. Now, if that land has to be good, the soil should be fertile enough to protect and culture that amount of fodder, generate that amount of fodder. The problem is we don't want to conserve the soil. We want to protect the tiger. I hope you are able to understand the concept, children. The same thing happens when I talk about the elephant. We all know, familiar from Coimbatore and other places, about Chinnathambi. Now, Chinnathambi started wandering, and we all blamed that poor little boy as something very nasty. This Chinnathambi is a very nasty elephant. Everybody started calling about the elephant. One single elephant requires almost, at an average, 0.75 kilometer square to 1 kilometer square of area through which every day he can pass through, enjoy the food from the plants, from the trees, and also drink water. Usually, there is not a single elephant. There are a group of elephants. So this group, 1 square kilometer is not enough. They start walking down. And the whole family, of course, I have a big video about it. I didn't want to show the video on this part over here because it'll take a long time. I have, in 1.5 hours, I would like to communicate the maximum ideas to you so that you can pursue it further. Now, when they walk through a jungle, happily, eating, walking, drinking, funny thing. So they take approximately about 1 year to go around and come back. Now, this pathway through which they walk is called as the elephant corridor. The path which they take is called as the elephant corridor. What we do is we put a road across it. And when the animal crosses that, we call it as the human-animal conflict. Now, here is where I want you children who are going to take up in future all these examinations, be familiar with the term zoonosis or zoonotic diseases. Zoo is animal. Animals, zoology is animal study, right? So diseases transferred from animals to human beings are called as zoonosis or zoonotic diseases. Children, please understand that today the world has already determined that even COVID-19, that is the corona disease which is spreading today, is partly because we have destroyed our own ecosystems. What normally happens is most of these smaller organisms like virus or bacteria, and if they are pathogenic or as pest, they live on other animals. And usually they live on mammals. You find ticks on dogs, on cats, and all those things. You would have noticed it, children. You are already aware of it. So most of these live on these mammals. And once you have a forest and they are happily living and interacting with each other, suddenly we decide as a policy to lay a big road through the forest. It can be a 6-lane or a 8-lane, a 2-vari sali or R-vari sali or the, whatever width of the road you can design. The moment you put the road, you cut down those forests and you start plying your vehicles, the mammals start moving away because they don't like human intervention. So when bigger mammals move away, the pests and parasites are looking for alternative hosts. They have to live. They have to survive. They have to adapt. So in such a situation, what happens? The moment you put the road, within a short time, you get some few tea stalls coming over there so that people can sell tea. On the way, you can stop, park, buy something to eat, drink, or have tea. Gradually, you get a few restaurants, and then the land will be sold, and then somebody would put plots over there. People live over there. And when human beings start living, these pests, which are depending on other mammals, start looking for new mammals, and human beings become very easy scapegoats for these pests. So most of the diseases can transfer by interrupting the natural ecosystems which exist in our world. When you look at a tree again, many people say tree gives us oxygen. Yes, tree gives us oxygen. But children, do you know that? How much oxygen do we breathe per day? We breathe almost 550 liters of oxygen per day. 550 liters of oxygen per day. And today, especially during this COVID, when oxygen is in demand, a 2.75 liter oxygen cylinder costs around 6,500 rupees. At that cost, we all breathe, each one of us, 13 lakh rupees worth of oxygen per day. You and I, we breathe 13 lakh rupees worth of oxygen per day. And a tree, a well-grown tree, a healthy tree, per year gives me almost 24 crore rupees worth of oxygen. Now, this is called as ecological economics. Because many people don't want to appreciate ecology. You have to tell them in terms of economy. Because economy takes an upper hand over ecology today. So children, this is a new branch, and I want you people to concentrate even on this branch. But we look at a tree as to what money it can give. So if I cut a tree, how much money it will give me? But when I cut a tree and when it rains, the soil splashes. And this topsoil goes away into the sea. Please understand, children, that nature at an average takes nature at an average takes 250 to 400 years to develop or generate 1 inch of topsoil. And this is the topsoil which gives us food to eat. That's very important. And these are all the soil biodiversity which supports us. I won't go into the details, just have an idea, children. These are all the soil biodiversity which supports us. And that gives us the organic matter. Organic matter is something like life for the soil. At an average Indian conditions, the tropical conditions, we are supposed to have at least 2 to 5% organic matter. Today, our national average, Indian national average, is around 0.4%. We have been mismanaging our soils. And the organic carbon is alarmingly depleting in most of the states which are marked red. This has been generated by International Federation of Organic Agriculture Movement, IFOAM. You can go into IFOAM, that is the International Federation of Organic Agriculture Movement's website. OFAI is Organic Farming Association of India. So this is completely reducing. Organic matter is reducing, and it's very alarming, very, very alarming. I have myself seen, you know, like my research has been on earthworms. I did my PhD in 1980s, you know, like I got my degree in 83. So when I started working in the Gindi National Park, the earthworm density, in 1998, almost 20 years later, I gave a similar topic to my own research student, and I found that the earthworm population is depleted by 5.3%. That's quite a big number. That's quite a big number for a reserve forest. I hope you understand the consequences. What happens with human intervention? What happens with human participation? I'm not against development. Are we balancing development with nature? This is what I want you people to think on, right? Of course, cattle. When you look at cattle, of course, it's our pride of our country. And when you look at our cattle, right, we used to use bulls for plowing the soil. And at the same time, we made use of the cow dung to make this cow dung cakes. Tamil varatin chonno. In Hindi, we call it as upla. And all this upla and varatis which we made, we used to use it for firewood. And we also used to prepare manure. The main priority were these. Milk was an additional. That is why we had our own local biodiversity, local cattle. And then the biogas plant came in. At the same time, this fellow came in. And once the tractor came in, what we said was, we don't need animals anymore because we have the tractor. The day in India, we eliminated cattle heads from agriculture, our decline started with production because organic matter to the soil started depleting. Because tractor can be good for plowing, but tractor does not give us dung. Is that clear? Fine. When I use a cattle plow, the soil rises up and that aerates my soil. When I use a heavy machinery, soil compaction takes place. And when compaction takes place, the soil air escapes. The soil air escapes. When the soil air escapes, soil organisms go down. The population goes down. And in India, we use almost 2 crore tons of chemical fertilizers per year and about 1 lakh tons of chemical pesticides per year. When we have a huge biodiversity for ourselves. All our governments, I'm not telling just India, Asia generally, because I work with many countries in Asia. So all our governments have been saying that our production is increasing. Yes, total production because of other reasons and other crops. But when you go and ask a farmer, especially because I'm familiar with my own Tamil Nadu farmers, when I ask my farmer, they very clearly say that once upon a time we used to harvest 30, 32 bags of paddy. 30-32 mutta nanga aruvada pannuvom. Whereas today, we are harvesting only around 25-26 bags of paddy per acre. So what happened is, after 2000, our production started decreasing. Per acre, per hectare. Fine, fair enough. This is how my farmer takes pesticide and then mixes it and then sprays it. And spraying, the industry says that I must use this sort of a mask. Please, those who would go into policy making future and political sciences students, please understand that this is what the company recommends. Whereas this is what my farmer does. Now, if you ask me, why don't you follow your company instructions? Even for this own COVID-19, we have been asked to use masks. And I hope you are able to understand how inconvenient it is in summer. And especially people like me who wear glasses. The moment I put on my glasses and I put on my mask and start driving, I find a small fog coming up my glasses. So, and the heat with this sort of plastic suits, you have seen already what happens with PPE suits. So this sort of a plastic wearing and the mask and things, can you expect my farmer to work in an open field? It doesn't work out. Moreover, most of these chemicals just infiltrate down into the groundwater and go and seep into the well water being drunk or consumed by the own farmers who live in rural areas. Now, most of the rural areas, many children suffer with stomachache. Now, policymakers and those students, political science students and ecological students or from the liberal arts and science institution from Kumaraguru, because you are generating a sustainability institute yourselves, my humble request is take a water analysis kit. Today, water analysis kit, simple kits are available for around 1,200 rupees. Go to rural areas where many children are suffering with stomachache and they think that it is because of Ascaris, Nakubuchi. But it is because of nitrate poisoning. You can easily test nitrates and try to recommend. And my humble request, because this is a technology institution as well, can you engineers who are listening to it design a simple mechanism for elimination of nitrates? Take up a challenge. UPSC can be your aim, but in between you can do a lot of things. When you learn, when you study, you get lots of opportunities, children. As I go through, I want you to take up some projects through this. Whether you achieve your dream of becoming an IAS officer, if not, you be somebody more than an IAS officer as somebody who is doing it for the public, right? IAS gives you the freedom to work, but fellows like me continue to work in the same way, right? We also talk about food security. But when you talk about food security, children, please understand there are three major components of food security. Political science students, please be very clear about it. Number one is availability of food. Do we have enough production? Do we have enough processing? Do we have water and soil management? How is the trade over there? This comes under availability. Yes, India has surplus production. We are proud of it. But second thing is access. Are we able to? Why should somebody in... I'm not challenging. Why should they? I say, is it necessary? I would put it that way. Is it necessary for somebody sitting in Kerala to eat a wheat puri or in Tamil Nadu to eat a wheat puri when wheat does not grow over there? Is it worth transporting all that material down south for the sake of food? Kerala once used to eat tapioca as one of the staple foods and the red rice. I used to go to Kerala because it's a neighboring state to me and lots of university seminars I have participated. Once upon a time when I used to go and during the 1980s when I used to make presentations, I would be served with that red rice with that mati fish curry and all those things and mixing with the papadam. The most delicious. But today when I go, I find only white rice and chapati is over there. So how we have changed our things and making this access so that the transportation increases and we talk about local biodiversity and we also talk about carbon. Understand the misconceptions have to be linked in policy making. And the last one is very important. Has everybody getting food? There is food, but is everybody getting food? I will not go into the details of analysis as a political analyst. I'm talking as an ecologist today. When I look at soil, this is how my soil looks. Totally barren, lifeless soil. This is from a beautiful field which I happened to see in the southern Andhra Pradesh. I happened to visit Madanapalli, this farm, and he's the farmer. Beautiful, wonderful person. Grows lovely tomatoes over there, and the border crop was marigold. Marigold is an excellent pest repellent, lovely pest repellent plant. You know, any insects which come, it can repel. So anybody has a home garden, please grow a few marigolds with you. I was so happy I praised him, but he laughed at me and said, no, sir, I grow them because a temple needs these flowers. So I asked him, what do you do with your tomatoes? He said, I use endosulfan on tomatoes. Endosulfan has been a nasty pesticide which was banned in Kerala, right? And this is such a corrosive pesticide. It corrodes their own hands. The same thing happens to our stomachs. This is what happens to the farmers over there. And endosulfan has caused a lot of problems in Kasaragod. And today, we do not know how we are going to manage with endosulfan on tomatoes. Of course, some pesticides are going to be banned. The government of India is taking a policy decision to ban a few pesticides. I only wish that they do it early. And the most common thing which we find in fields is burning things. Of course, many people will immediately think about Punjab and Rajasthan. There's no point blaming anybody. What I'm trying to tell is they at least are burning fodder. But when you look at many of the farms down south, there is a habit of buying any organic matter and burning it on the field. So that they get the ash. And ash is supposed to be rich in organic, in potassium and elements. But what burns is something different. So when these things burn, dioxins go into the soil. And they start contaminating my soil. At the same time, we have been adding a lot of other things into the soil. Children, if you look at this particular blue slide here, this particular term, glyphosate. Please see this carefully, glyphosate. Glyphosate is a very, very nasty chemical. Very nasty chemical. It comes in a pesticide called as Roundup. Now, this glyphosate, if it is sprayed on a field, and if there was grass over there, and if a pregnant cow eats that grass, then it can lead to abortions. These are called as herbicide-tolerant plants. I will not go into the details again because of the brevity of time. HT plants, be careful with them. HT plants, which are being brought in. And these pesticides can cause chronic health effects, like all these effects. And this, once upon a time, when I used to do some projects for Punjab, I used to see most of the farmers and the doctors and the children using this sort of asthma controllers, they call them as inhalers. But today I find them in Chennai. Every part, our air quality is falling down. And today, pesticide angle has been given to Parkinson. Almost every household has at least one or two relatives suffering from Parkinson's. And most of the children suffering from cancerous substances. This is from Chennai Cancer Institute. So all this is growing. And this is a train which goes from Bathinda in Punjab to Bikaner in Rajasthan. And every day, lots of farmers travel by this train suffering with cancer because there's a cancer hospital in Bikaner. This train is called as the Cancer Express. You can Google for it. You'll get all the information. Seeds. Children, please get this concept very clear. As a policymakers, please get this very clear. Seeds. You see, it's very easy to count the number of seeds in a fruit which you eat. Supposing I give you a custard apple, sitapalam or sitapal, and ask you to count the number of seeds in that when you eat. You can easily keep the seeds aside. You can count and say there are about 40 seeds, 30 seeds, whatever it is. But no human being can guess how many fruits will come from each seed, right? That is what we call it as God, or we call it as nature. Our traditional seeds, which we call, please, children, remember this term. They are no more called as traditional. They are called as heirloom seeds. They are called as heirloom seeds. Please remember these terms. Today, when you go and buy seeds in the market, most of you would have seen this, that they are very colored seeds. Now, this coloration usually, not necessarily, but usually is because of the use of a pesticide which has lots of a substance, chemical substance called as neonicotinoids. Please note it down. Neonicotinoids. Now, neonicotinoids are the fifth generation pesticides, and they are neurotoxic substances. They can hurt our brain. Not from the plants and the vegetables which grow from it, but from the people who are handling it. So supposing unknowingly my farmer who handles it, we are aware that our farmers may be using a BD or smoking while they are planting these seeds. So they use the cigarette or the BD and then they plant 4 or 5 seeds and again they touch their fingers to their lips. So passively they can consume this sort of chemicals into their bodies. And homemakers who are using terrace gardens, please be careful when you use these seeds. Don't give it in the hands of children and wash your hands properly after usage. We have worked a lot of information. We did a lot of research work on this, and we did a lot of experiments in Theni where we could find that termite soil mixed with cow dung and urine, make it a paste, soak the seeds in it, dry them in shade and plant them. Does the same purpose. Can we harness our natural resources? These are all cues I'm giving you, children. Work out projects on it. Design yourself. Once upon a time, we had farmers' seeds. Nobody else. Farmers will grow, and especially women. We're very proud of our women who actually conserved our seeds. Most of the biodiversity in our country was conserved by women, not by men. The farmers used to harvest, give the first bunch of seeds to the women folk, and the women folk used to protect them with prayers. But today, all industry has come in, and we are gradually moving from biodiversity to genetic slavery. In what way is it? This is what is genetic engineering, where we bring them and form a bond, right? We use restrictor enzymes to cleave and we use ligase enzymes to bond. This is what is called as genetic engineering. And that conflict has come in. So what? We are already using hybrids. Why not we use GMOs? Hybrids are different. Hybrids is you take lemon with lemon, it's a hybrid. Mango with mango is a hybrid. Brinjal with brinjal is a hybrid. GMO, genetically modified organisms, where you take a totally unrelated organism, a gene from a totally unrelated organism, and introduce in a different organism. The mostly preferred organism has been BT, that is Bacillus thuringiensis. the bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis. Why do we need this? Because we want to be God. We want to play God. Because nature or God did not know how to create fruits. Nature or God did not know how to create vegetables. So we want to play God. We want to play God because of a selfish reason. Because if I introduce a gene, I have a patent on it. So I play God. I get money out of it. For us in India, food is medicine. Tamil makkalukku unave marandhu. Food is medicine. It is only for Westerners and Europeans. They require medicine in food. Unavil marandhu. We don't require medicine in food. Because for us, food is medicine. First, they wanted to introduce golden rice. Children who are appearing for competitive examinations understand the concept. Golden rice was a rice where carotene was introduced as a gene. Now, whenever we say about carotene, right from school days, we have been told the relationship between carrot and carotene. So, in fact, NEET examination had this question 2 years back. What was the gene, sourced gene for carotene pigment in golden rice? Many children wrote down as carrot. It's not carrot. The gene was derived from a beautiful flower. You all know the answer. Guess it. Some of you would have studied Wordsworth's poem. Yeah. I wandered lonely as a cloud. Yeah, some of you guessed it right. Daffodils. The gene was taken from daffodils. This daffodil gene was incorporated to give carotene pigmentation. We fought against it. They wanted to bring in cotton. BT cotton is always written with a capital B and a small t. Uppercase B and a lowercase t. Because it represents the generic name Bacillus and the specific name Thuringiensis. It is not biotechnology cotton. Please, those children who have not studied science, please remember that. BT stands for Bacillus thuringiensis. Now, this cotton was introduced and people said, this is non-edible, man. Of course, this shirt which I'm wearing is a cotton shirt. So, cotton has been derived from this cotton. So what? So what? But unfortunately, when you go down south, in Madurai, people prepare milk out of cotton seeds. And in Nagapattinam and Nagore, people prepare halwa out of cotton seeds. It's called as Parthi halwa and the Parthi pal. Now, when you look at these things at the same time, cotton seeds are ground, oil is extracted, and the oil seed cake is fed to the cattle, and the milk is drunk by human beings. So what is the relationship and the nuances involved? We do not know. The long-term consequences? We do not know. And then they wanted to bring in brinjal. One brinjal for the whole country. BT brinjal by the company. Now, many of you may say, so what? Let us have one type of brinjal. Why should I have one type of brinjal when India has more than 60 varieties? More than 60 varieties of brinjal are today cultivated in India. And Tamil Nadu alone has 22 varieties of brinjal today. And children, I would appreciate those appearing for public service examinations. Please be familiar with an organization called as the National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources. It's the government of India, NBPGR, National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources, which has 4,460 accessions of brinjal. Do I need one brinjal? Fair enough. Then they want to bring in mustard. North Indian children who are listening to me, yeah, do you remember mustard? For you, mustard oil. Mustard oil is very, very essential. Yeah, Tamil kadugu nu solluvom illaya adha. And Hindi, it's sarson. So when you look at sarson or kadugu or mustard, they wanted to introduce a new concept and call it as DMH11. Many thought it is not a BT. Many thought it is not biotechnology. It is only DMH11 is a hybrid. It was introduced as Dhara Mustard Hybrid 11. But children, it is a hybrid of a genetically modified parrot. And here they have not used Bacillus thuringiensis. Please, children, note down. It is Bacillus amyloliquefaciens. Bacillus amyloliquefaciens. This is also going to be a HT plant, herbicide-tolerant plant, just like BT cotton. Herbicide-tolerant plant. And here they are going to use a pesticide glufosinate basta and not glyphosate, which was used over there. Clear? And this is where I am a bit worried. Seed bill. As political scientists and analysts, those teachers who are handling this, please go through this draft bill. The draft seed bill 2019, I'm not going to the details of this bill now here. Just understand that in this bill, they are going to bring in a new thing saying that farmers should get guaranteed seeds. And these guaranteed seeds will be sold only by a company. So corporate business is going to introduce seeds to the farmers. Whereas once upon a time, farmers used to exchange seeds. So today, exchanging a seed by a farmer may be illegal. So what happens to our food sovereignty? Bija Swaraj kya hua? Please understand. I'm not going to the details. Please go through it. I'm just polishing the whole thing through because I have to be fast. I have just another 45 minutes left to complete so that you can interact with me. Right? Please understand, children, basmati has been our rice. Right? We enjoy it, biryani. And especially in South India, we think only about biryani when we think about basmati. Of course, Jeera Sambha is a very good competitor for biryani. But in North India, most of the places I have seen that even for daily food, some of them prefer basmati. The United States takes our germplasm, just modifies one or two genes in the University of Texas and calls it as Tex-Mati. Calls it as Tex-Mati. Is it okay? Government of India fights a big case. CSIR goes into competition, goes in for a big international case. Finally, we won the case. And we have a GI tag on basmati, the global indicator. And those, my children from Tamil Nadu, you should be proud that today, Koyilpetty Kadala Mitai has gained a GI tag. Yeah. So there's always a competition by biodiversity and biotechnology. Biodiversity can create all the judo, karate, hoo-ha, fight, but biotechnology will shoot it down. I'm not against biotechnology. Those of you who suddenly feel that, why are you so crazy, you're old-minded, old man, that you are against biotechnology. No, I'm not against biotechnology. I'm talking to you as a former head of the Department of Biotechnology. Now, biotechnology is like most of the technologies over here are just like a knife. With the knife, you can peel a potato or you can kill a person. It is not the technology per se that I am against. I am against the technology being applied in certain jurisdictions of life. Biotechnology, especially this particular recombinant technology, is excellent because insulin is a product of that same technology, which goes through a lot of case histories, lots of trials before it's being introduced. Whereas in food crop, there is always a sort of a moratorium which has to be conducted in a local environmental conditions. Why is it that we usually compromise? I leave it to you again. People are planning to bring in transgenic animals. There has been a series of research where I had been reading when I was in biotechnology long, long back as to whether we can introduce some genes from the fish into tomato so that the tomato outer skin can be strong like a scale so that it can be preserved and have a longer shelf life. Already, they have succeeded in introducing transgenic salmon. Of course, they call it a salmon fish. We call it as salmons. So they are trying to introduce all those things. And RBGS now is being introduced into a new sort of a hormone. Recombinant bovine growth technology being introduced as recombinant bovine growth hormone, which becomes a somatotropic hormone. Somatotropic means increases the body. Now this somatotropic hormone, if it is injected into this cow, then it could produce all the milk you want. So somebody can gain all the money, all these recent developments. Please try to update yourself, children. You can take the milk out of it, but within about three and a half years, the cattle will develop the diseases of the udder, which is mastitis. This is on one side. But on the other side, if you look at the human welfare impact, how one person's money can cause distress to somebody else, that children in rural areas drinking this milk, because in rural areas, milk will not be pasteurized. So those children who drink this milk, especially girl children, will attain puberty at the age of 8 or 9. Their whole hormone system can get affected. I used to talk about this, but today there was recently, this is from a television channel, Tamil television channel, where this calf has been born. Just born female calf. In a few minutes or hours, it stands up to suckle milk from its mother. To suckle milk from its mother, but look at its udder. This little calf, just born calf, is giving half a liter of milk because of hormonal disturbances. Now, where are we moving? What are our policies? Why are we cultivating biodiversity? Please update yourself, children. And when I look at soil, because soil has been my own compartment, my own life. Because I worked my entire research in soil, because no soil, no food. And soil, it's more important than you think. Children, 2015, that's the reason was declared as the International Year of Soils. So I have always been giving life a sort of a description to the soil. Not for life in the soil, but soil as a living organism, which I wrote in my Tamil book, Man Makkal Mahasul. Now, when you look at the soil, and I started describing soil, people ask me whether soil living, whether it has a digestive system. To me, yes, it has a digestive system, because when I find a dead animal lying on the surface of the soil, 1 or 2 days, I get a bad smell out of it. But when I dig a pit, put the animal into it and bury it, I don't get the smell. When I ask people what is happening, they say something is happening inside. It's getting completely digested. I said, ask who does it? Microorganisms do it. Now, who is there in my intestine? Microorganisms. So logically speaking, I have a digestive system. So logically speaking, soil also has a digestive system. People ask me whether it has a respiratory system. Just like we take in oxygen, give out carbon dioxide, soil also takes in oxygen, gives out carbon dioxide. So soil logically has a respiratory system. People ask me whether it has a circulatory system. Very simple. When I get hurt in my toe and the doctor gives me a tablet, I don't feed the tablet to my toe. I feed the tablet into my mouth. The blood takes it over there. You have plants at home. Do you pull out the plant every day out and then feed the roots? No. You put water or manure or fertilizer on top of the soil. How does it go inside? By burrows and channels created by soil organisms. So soil logically has a circulatory system. They ask me whether it has an excretory system. We go to the toilet to throw out unwanted salt. Urea is a salt which we throw out in the form of urine. If you go to any saline soil or sodic soil, you will find that the salts are brought and thrown out, thrown up above the soil. So soil logically has an excretory system. Then they ask me whether it has a reproductive system. Well, we all know about in vitro fertilization. We all know about test tube babies. What do we do with them? Of course, after fertilization, artificial fertilization, where should the embryo be? Where should the zygote be incubated? Where should it be incorporated? In the uterus of the mother. Unless it is being introduced in the uterus of the mother, the child cannot grow. So your tissue culture plant, wherever it is, however it is, has to be incorporated into the soil. Only if it is planted in the soil, the tree will grow. Finally, they asked me whether it has a brain. That was a very complicated question, in fact, whether it has a brain. Because the common slang in many of the schools is the teacher will say that whether we have soil in our heads, right? It's a compliment. Next time, if somebody tells you at home, take it as a compliment. Because soil definitely has a brain. Because when I dig a pit and put any biomass into it, it will decompose. But when I put a seed into it, it will germinate. Yes, soil can distinguish what it has to decompose and what it has to germinate. So soil has a thinking potential, a living soil. That is where we distinguish between soil fertility and soil health. Soil fertility has been a component of chemical farming because it is related to fertilizers. You go and give your soil for analysis to any laboratory, any government laboratory or any soil testing laboratory. After analyzing, giving you a report on NPK and also the micronutrients, pH and electroconductivity, they will give you a recommendation as how much of fertilizer should be added. Whereas soil health is not man valam, but man nalam. You know, health of the soil, which involves the smell of the soil, the fragrance of the soil, the microbial density of the soil. Unfortunately, most of the soil is nutrients are depleting in the soil. And nutrient-depleted soil produces nutrient-depleted fruits, and nutrient-depleted fruits are causing unwanted diseases in human beings. This has been completely been worked out by lots of groups, and they have identified how by 2010 onwards, nutrient depletion has taken place in most of the foods which we harvest. It's not there. It's depleting. On the other side, we talk about waste management. Shall we start thinking them about resource management as a policy? The first step of waste management, please talk about waste reduction. The Sustainability Institute of Living, your traditional sciences at Kumaraguru, I request that you put up this as the first statement. Waste reduction is important. Waste management can be by different sources. I talk about composting because I worked a lot on this aspect. One side, we have aerobic composting, where air goes inside, produces manure. The other thing can be anaerobic. It can also be composting inside pits, or usually we produce biogas out of it, because methane can be produced by anaerobic decomposition. Vermitech is using earthworms. Vermi is derived from the form vermis, and tech is technology. So applying technology using earthworms, the earthworm biotechnology. All earthworms in the world, there are about more than 500 species of earthworms in India. But all earthworms in the world can be classified into three types. The ones which live on the surface, epigeic worms. Epi means above, geic means soil. Above, which actually do the composting process. The second group are the anisics, the burrowers. Anisics means intermediates. And the third are the bottom living, right? Endo means inside the soil. So there are three varieties, and these are the three common varieties in South India. Of course, you get Ferritima, which is now called as Metaferritima, and other type of species in North India. Right? This is how an earthworm works. The earthworm goes, takes food, this food enters the mouth, these are the gizzards which crush the food, these are the hearts. The food enters the stomach, which is called as the crop, and the digested food goes into the intestine. Every segment has nephridia, kidney-like structures which pour urea inside. So the urea and carbon combine together, and this comes out as casting, which we call it as a vermicast. So that's the vermicast. And these are the cocoons produced by the earthworms after mating, and the young ones are born from the cocoons in this way. So that's how the earthworms multiply. Vermicomposting is very simple. You compost the material. First, you compost the material. After it loses heat, you introduce the worms and give a cow dung cake and leave a cow dung cake. I told you that in India, we used to use and prepare a lot of cow dung cakes, varati or upli or upla, and the earthworms multiply in them. But today, you know where these are available? Amazon and Flipkart are selling it. Please understand political scientists and economists. What is the cost of it which is being purchased from my farmer? And that's vermicompost. That's vermicompost. This is a simple way of doing composting. I'll not go into the details. The procedures are available on my website. I'll give it to you in the final things. You process the whole thing and then you produce vermicompost. Very simple ways we have been teaching farmers. We have been teaching local people. In rural areas, it's just to dig a pit, which is about 3 feet diameter, 1.5 feet deep, in the form of a basin, and put the soil around it, put some cow dung in the middle, generates microorganisms and earthworms, come over there. And then after about 10 or 15 days, you start planting greens like coriander, methi, mint, that is pudina, and spinach or palak on the inner side. And then you have tomato, brinjal, and other things on the outer side. So on one side, you are doing your waste management or resource management. On the other side, you are harvesting your own vegetables. All this is possible. This is what we have been teaching to a large section of people here through our Department of Rural Development and Panchayat Raj. Right? So industrial waste management is also possible. Sugar industry can easily manage the waste. This is what we had designed for solid waste management through vermicomposting for your TVS 50 group, which the TVS group, which manufactures motorcycles. And in the process, I developed this unit, which is being now patronized by the pollution control boards. Very simple units, which is open on one side because women folk can easily handle it. It has holes in it. And this is what was designed for Godrej company by a student of mine. And this is what has been done at MRC Nagar in Chennai. So Department of Rural Development and Panchayat Raj has taken a pioneerage. In fact, the tabletop book by the Government of India is only this work which has been done by the Department of Rural Development and Panchayat Raj of the Government of Tamil Nadu, which has taken it. This is my country. So whenever I go to rural areas, the temples open up for me for lectures and talks to the people over there, after which we demonstrate to them on the rural areas and teach them. Children who are working on these things, because some of the college is based in Coimbatore. I know that Pollachi and Coimbatore built, lots of people are doing vermicomposting. Please be aware of this particular planarian, Bipallium cavense, which can, this is how it will look like. It will have a triangular head in the front. Please watch it carefully. Now, this fellow is nasty. He can go and catch hold of worms and eat the worms. And most of the people in Coimbatore and Pollachi belt, you have coconut farms. Whenever you do composting, you will get these caterpillars. These are the stages which lead or grow into rhinoceros beetles. They are the larvae of rhinoceros beetle. So if you happen to see them, give it to the chicken in your farm. They will eat them. Otherwise, they will become as rhinoceros beetles which can attack your coconut fields. But I am worried. I am worried because this machine is coming into existence and people say that this can produce compost in 24 hours. I think human beings are born in 10 months and not in 10 minutes. In the same way, compost cannot be produced in 24 hours. Compost requires its own time. These are all volume reducing machines. If at all you really want a digester, biodigester, which can digest in 24 hours, better invest in cattle. Cattle can eat this and give you dung in 24 hours, and dung can easily be composted. Or you can produce biogas. Why I'm trying to tell you all this is, you are going for a field station, field visit, you happen to see beautiful fish in the pond, you want to take it to your house after 3 or 5 days, 3 or 4 days. But you don't have a refrigerator, you don't have a fridge with you. So what will you do? They are dead already when you take them out. But you want to retain them for 3 to 4 days. What do? You add salt to it. When you add salt to it, microorganisms don't multiply. If microorganisms don't multiply, what happens? The fish becomes a dry fish, karwada. So if I keep adding salt to my soil, which I called it as a living soil, I keep on adding salt because nitrate is a salt of nitrogen, phosphate is a salt of phosphorus, potassium is a salt of potassium. What happens to my fish? Well, what happens to my soil? Soil also becomes something like a karwada, a dry fish. At the same time, children, you should know that when I take food and there's too much of salt in my food, what do I immediately require? Water. The same way, soil management cannot be separated from water management. So in a chemical feed, when I add salt and I give water, water immediately goes away because salt takes away more of the water. Can you do a lot of projects on this? Please go ahead. We have done a lot of experiments which have seen how water is being conserved in these soils. Please proceed and do a lot of experiments. Mulching is very important because mulch conserves heat as well, conserves water in the soil and prevents it from heating your roots. These are all lovely, lovely things which you can understand, children. And moreover, more and more on policies, especially Kumaraguru College, for you also, I'm giving you some information, is when you're walking on the road and there's a rain and you hold an umbrella, the water doesn't fall on my head. It falls around the umbrella. If I don't have an umbrella, I stand under the shade of a tree. Then a few drops may fall on my head, but most of the water falls around the tree. Why should water fall around the tree? What reason is it? Nature is an excellent teacher. Water falls around the tree because the roots we drink are there. So where should I water the tree? Where the canopy is there. Where should I water? Where the canopy is there. And what do? We water near the trunk. This is how we teach. This is what Polachi Madhuram Krishna's farm. The entire trench has been made so that water goes over there. And what we do? We put it near the trunk and then we say that nothing is growing. So we make mistakes, learn, prepare a lot of foliar sprays. Vermi wash is one of them. This is the circulatory system of the soil through which we prepare the vermi wash. This is the first drum of vermi wash which I created in 1982. This costed me 200 rupees in 1982 because of the cost of the rum and the inputs. Farmers who came said, sir, 200 rupees, because 200 rupees in 1982 was some money. I said, no, 50 rupees. One small farmer came, he said, Ambadur Baba. I said, no, 10 rupees. At that time, this pot costed me 10 rupees. So children, whatever you may come up in life as engineering students, whatever you technology you develop, please see to it, it becomes affordable. Panchakavya is excellent. He's Dr. Natarajan from Kodumudi. He has done extensive work on this. This is how you prepare Panchakavya. Don't worry about the slides. All this is available on my website. I'll give it to you finally. He is Natarajan and I. He works with Panchakavya. I work with Vermi Wash. A combination gave us excellent results. This is FEM, Farmers Effective Microorganisms. From fish waste, we prepare fish amino. From buttermilk and coconut milk, we prepare this for protecting the flowers in plants. Bioenzyme is picking up today. Very simple, children. You can do a lot of work on this. You can change a lot of policies. You can bring a lot of policies, especially for rural areas where septic tanks and soak pits exist. This can help in a lot of decomposition process which can happen for our own bio waste. Simple things for you people at home. Just put all the banana peels you eat in a dabba or a plastic box, pour water, leave it for 4 or 5 days. Use the surface liquid. Or just dry them, shred them, mix them with eggshells. Eggshells is a policy matter. As a political analyst or as an economic person, just dry the eggshells or just roast them slightly, add vinegar. Vinegar is acetic acid and eggshells have lots of calcium and elements in it. So the moment you add, it starts bubbling. In about 2 days, all the elements come in the liquid. Dilute it, spray it. There are lots of scientists in the farm. Please understand the concepts I'm telling you, because you people, once you become officers, you don't need to depend on advice from other people. You are an excellent brain. Each individual is an excellent brain. Every farm, every village has a scientist. And the greatest scientist is a professor whom I would like to introduce. He is Professor Goat. Goat can eat all sorts of plants. Goat eats all sorts of plants, but some plants a goat will never eat. The plants which a goat does not eat. So what it eats, let it eat. What it says, you take it. A plant which a goat does not eat has pest repellent properties in it. That is why this plant at the bottom is called as Aada Thoda. Aada Thoda. The name comes from Tamil. Aadu Thodaadadu. So a plant which a goat does not touch, take those plants, crush them, soak them, ferment them. They work marvelous as pest repellents. People ask me how much of soil is required for me to grow a plant. Not at all. For growing mint, you require only 4 inches of soil. To grow your methi or fenugreek or vendium at home, what you require is just a sweet box. You can grow them. They're all beautiful plants which you can grow. In fact, one of my students grows them in coconut shells in schools. Right? How much of water is required for a plant? Supposing I come to you, to a Kumbhal Guru, and say, ma'am, I would like to have some water to drink. You will give me a glass of water. If I say I have not had a bath, you may give me a bucket of water. If I say I want to have a swim, you may show me a swimming pool. So I need only a glass of water. Similarly, plants require soil moisture. Unfortunately, I have seen in many institutions, you just put the pipe and leave the water open. Goes. Water has become a constraint. This is how the well was during my grandfather's time. This is how the well is today. This is how it's going to be when you become grandparents. So can we proceed with rainwater harvesting? This is my house where I do a lot of rainwater harvesting. But I do one more thing, which I want your institutions to grow. You engineers should come up with new technologies. Most of the water from every house comes from the washing machine, laundry, and from bathroom, because we have the habit of taking bath. Almost 65 to 70% of the water is coming from that direction. Now, this water has only soap in it. If this water can be treated by these plants, either Phragmites or Canna or Colocasia, just very simple, just put a tank like this. For a small household which has less than 1,000 liters of water per day, use a 6x4 tank with baffles in between, making the water flow through it, and grow these plants straight away into it. They happily grow over there, and they look like this. This is washing machine water, which is made to pass through it. I'll be a bit faster because by 12, yeah, I have another 20 minutes for 12. The water gets cleaned up, and this water can be used for recharging the wells, this recharging the groundwater. They can be used for flushing the toilets. This can be used for your garden very happily. Your institutions have hostels. Please put it. Please do it. But new challenges are coming in. Can you work on them? Some of you engineering students, can you come out with new challenges? Can you try to operate this? Medical waste is going to be a challenge. Sanitary napkins, as everybody claims, every hostel claims that we have a machine. But today we are getting a lot of problems with adult diapers today. And electronic waste, of course, has always been a challenge. This is where one more thing which I would like to tell you is the MSP. I will not go into the details. MSP is minimum support price. For a few crops, there are minimum support prices. But many of the farmers are made to sell their products at a cost less than the MSP. Can we work on it? Of course, the MS Swaminathan Commission has given a recommendation. It's a very good recommendation to the Government of India. But the Government of India has not been implementing it over a period of time. I'm not telling you about the present thing. Over a period of time. So can we start thinking about it? People spoke about locust some days back. This is a current topic, so it may be asked to you children in your own examinations. Locusts are grasshoppers which go wild because of serotonin, a sort of a secreted substance, neurosecreted substance. Now, many people say, why don't we develop pheromones and attract them? They don't need pheromones because they're always flying as partners. So they don't go in search of a female. Only if there is a search for a female or a male, then we can use a pheromone trap. They leave eggs at the bottom of the soil. This is how they grow. I'll not go into the details of it, but please understand, children. Many people say they came, but why did they come? One of the most important theories I want you to understand. I want you to understand, children, that there is a concept called as the Indian Ocean Dipole. Please note it down. Please refer it later. In the Indian Ocean Dipole, the east coast of Africa is usually warmer than the west coast of India. So the rains come towards India. But during 1918-19, what happened? The Arctic disaster of glaciers melting brought in cold water down. And this cold water had a narrow place to escape through Australia, so it accumulated here. Gradually, Eastern Africa, east side, became cooler than Western India. So unexpected rains started falling on the Horn of Africa. And Northern Horn of Africa, what happened? They started getting more rains, so the eggs hatched out, and this population multiplied, the locusts. These locusts started moving from there, came into Middle East, went into other portions, came to Afghanistan, Pakistan, and came into India. People spoke about control. They said you can create smoke, you can create noise, but how much can you do it? Then they said, why not we use malathion? Just like endosulfan, take malathion, spray it from helicopters, from everything. What will have, how much impact will it have on all the soil organisms, all the other organisms, and human beings living over there, or other organic phosphorus pesticides? The third group said, why not we use 3G? 3G is using ginger, garlic, and green chilies in mixed up with oils, adding soap to it, and things like that. Or use fungus like metarhizium, right? So all these components are coming in. But why did it happen? Is it because of loss of biodiversity? Many birds used to eat them away, but today we don't have these. Or is it because the soil dwellers have vanished? Otherwise, most of the centipedes would have eaten most of the eggs over there. Or is it because of monocropping? I'm giving it all to you people to think about. I'm not going to give you answers for this. But one thing which always triggers me is, what helped them hatch? It was torrential rains where it shouldn't have happened. It shouldn't have happened over that side. But what triggered those rains? Melting of ice caps. Abnormally high Indian Ocean dipole. But why did it happen? Climate change. So who did the climate change? We. So impact of human beings. So please understand these concepts. Please also understand this. Classification, reclassification, land is happening. Wetland is sadupanilam. We know about it. We know wetlands are very good for us. Wasteland is something different. I was chairman for one of the inquiry committees by the High Court of Chennai. I had the shock of my life when I asked a government official to submit the papers about the land. And the land was reclassified as waste wetland. I have never heard this classification in my entire life. Waste wetland. A wetland can never be a wasteland. And once you construct as engineers, be careful, civil engineers, you construct your buildings on it. This is what will happen in future. Right? Fly ash is becoming a problem throughout the world. I had been a member of another committee to investigate into this. This, can you bring a change? I will not go into details because of subjudice things. This fly ash is dumped so much that even buildings can submerge. There's a school building. You find only the terrace. The whole village has been boycotted, has been evacuated in a better way. So we rank 177 in 180 in environmental performance index. And at this time, the new EIA 2020 is causing anxiety. This says that any problem, only Pollution Control Board, Groundwater Authority, and similar authorities can question. Public or NGO or civil societies cannot question. I'm leaving it open. Just for discussion, you people can have it. Political department, please raise a sort of a debate and have a debate on it. And there'll be no public consultation. Only body of experts. So it is something like I appoint my examiner to evaluate my own student who will be a classmate of mine. Third, the State Environment Impact Assessment Authority, the members will be appointed by the Government of India, not by the state. How it will be called a State Environmental Impact Assessment Authority? Will it work out? And fourth, I can start an industry and then go for a clearance. Something like in many of the institutions, We you know, like the boss always passes a resolution and then you say ratification later. Or is it surgery first and then you diagnose the patient? These are the questions raised. The era is moving. We are moving into nutrigenomics where food will be declared as per your genome, how your genes are. So this will be genetic nutrition. And similarly, medicines are going to move so that it becomes expensive. Depending on your own gene concept, medicine will be produced. And hunger is increasing in my country. Hunger is increasing in my country. We are going very, very backwards in hunger index. So please, children, from today, don't waste food. We have no business to waste food. Don't waste food. We are a group of undernourished population. Gradually, we are eating a lot, but we are undernourished. So children, I always introduce this topic because it is my pet topic over here. Please see to it that we follow food according to our national flag. Our national flag is not just with respect, with all due respects as a national flag, which we call it as a tricolor. It gives us a lot of information. My tricolor tells me, eat food which is orange in color, saffron in color. That means eat something daily which is of that color. It can be your carrot, it can be papaya, it can be mango, it can be orange, it can be pumpkin. It gives me carotene. I don't need America's golden rice. The second color is white. Most of our children, especially girls in the family, the women folk, you require a lot of calcium. Take some amount of milk. And if you don't want to be milk, you want to be vegan, take a proper substitute for it. The third color is a green color. And green colored vegetables have fiber in it. See to it that you take green colored vegetables every day. Unfortunately, when I go to Delhi for meetings and I go to a vegetarian hotel and usko puchta hu ke bhai aaj kya sabzi hai, wo kehta hai ke sab paneer hai sab. I don't know when paneer became a vegetable. Paneer is vegetarian but not a vegetable, right? So please see to it that you take green colored vegetables. The wheel is blue in color. Right from childhood, we paint the water blue. So take sufficient quantity of water. And how many lines in the wheel? 24. 24 hours follow our national flag. We don't need any other food from any part of the world. This is what my school, I studied in St. Joseph of Cluny, Pondicherry. That was my primary school. And whenever I go there, this is what they serve me. Our food, South Indian food, is arusuvai, six flavors, which provides all the nutrition for us. And you think that these two are going to solve our problem? I'm not against any food. Once in a way, you have it as a student. You go out with your friends, you're having it, okay. But don't make it as a habit. Color in food. Take it as a political analysis. Take it as a passive analysis. In your traditional institutions, you know, like when I was a kid, I used to buy a sweet, leave it on the table, go play and come, there will be ants on it. Today, you buy a sweet, leave it on the table, even for 2 days, there are no ants coming to it. So do I want to feed sweets to a child, which even the ants won't eat? So much of color, Smithsonian Institution has done a lot of research on this. Sugar with color given to ants. You can find all the color going into the stomach. Many children are exposed to high activity because of these things. Some of the dangerous colors, which we have been commonly been using, that we want to have our kesari orange in color. Why? Can't kesari be white in color? Can't we use some organic inputs? Please understand that I have done a lot of work on this with in association with the Consumer Association of Penang. This Pulau Penang is Consumer Association of Malaysia. I have done a lot of work over there. It's easy for me. So all these red-colored chicken pakoras or red-colored gobi pakoras, they all cause a lot of problems for health. Orange is this in color. Then why is this drink red in color? You can guess the drink. You know what the drink is. I don't want to name companies over here. Especially this slide is from the in ITRC Lucknow, which is Government of India institution, that many of the sweet shops which are selling sweets with this so-called silver foil is not silver. It is a combination of five heavy metals. Be careful as to what you eat. It can destroy your kidney because it's a combination of nickel, lead, copper, chromium, and cadmium. Right? And fruits, calcium carbide is being used. Children, be careful as to what you buy from the market and eat. This is how your fruit will ripen. If you find black spots in grade number 4 or 3, that means it has been ripened artificially. The same thing happens with your yellow banana. It ripens from one end to another. If you find dark green on both the ends with yellow in the middle, it has been ripened with artificial ripeners. So what is the easiest way of eating healthy? Don't eat what is advertised on TV. Food doesn't require an advertisement. Is that clear, children? Plastics. Again, policy. Policy makers, you children, you should be aware that there used to be 6 type of plastics. Today, we have the 7th type of plastic, which is any other plastic. All this numbered plastic alone should be there. Can you work against non-numbered plastic? This is how plastic should be numbered. There will be a triangle with a number inside. Don't buy plastic which has no number inside. 1, 2, and 5 used to be used for food products. This is what happened when I went to a meeting in Delhi and they were keeping a tumbler on the table. There's a triangle, but the number is missing. Number is missing. This is number 7 plastic. It is coming in, even feeding bottles are going to come in plastic number 7. It should be declared as BPA free. As a policy analyst, can you insist on this? In New Zealand, they have to, for any children boxes, they have to declare phthalate-free and BPA-free because phthalate is an endocrine disruptor. Styrofoam plates are still there in the market, and styrofoam plates are not meant for food. They are meant for ice creams or bread, right? If you put anything hot in it, it leaches out. And styrene goes into the food. So what you're eating is cancer. Microplastics, can we work against it? Can we see to it what is happening to the environment? Environment is not, doesn't mean pollution alone. Unfortunately, right from school, we have been told environment, sutrasural means soil pollution, water pollution, air pollution. No. These microplastics are being popularized, but these microplastics have now entered into drinking water bottles. Microplastic has come in salts. Microplastic has come in fish. And just in June 2020, a new research has found out microplastics have entered into fruits and vegetables. So children, be creative. My humble request, be creative. What is creativity? Well, here is a man who is trying to create a music. Madam doesn't like it. Breaks it. So should he cry? No, convert it into a tabla. That is creativity in life. And most of you people who are listening to me would be engineers. So please move from being a professional engineer to a societal engineer. Children, design social needs. Keep all these in mind before taking up an engineering design. As an IAS officer, as an officer, or as a human being, update your knowledge. Children, please update knowledge. By knowledge, I don't mean degrees. Update your knowledge. Dream beyond the binding. And only reading can make you come up in life. Reading can make your life. And if you're going to do this sort of work, you must have patience in you. Patience in you. Because today, people wait to push you down at the slightest pretext. Have patience in you, children. Do it. Let us reverb the world. Today, when the rain comes, water is not infiltrating because the soil is all jam-packed. Can we bring back the earthworms in our soils? And these earthworms can create channels. And when the rain comes, water can enter inside. It's beautiful. People spoke about global warming. I speak about global warming. Because this term vermitech, which you heard, which some of you have studied in your school, especially teachers, you would have studied these books when you were in school. The term vermitech was coined by me for the world. That is my contribution. The entire research. Asked who coined the term vermitech. And today, I'm honored that the new book, Zoology textbook, has my work contributed in the textbook. I studied zoology, right? So children, it's not what your degree or your position makes what you are. It's your passion makes what you are. So whatever you want to do, do it. But do it with passion. Achieve it. One humble request to you, children. When it rains and the water falls in the soil, whom does this water belong to? Whom does this water belong to? You may say soil. Now, supposing you take a pot from your house and keep it and collect water in that pot. Now, whom does that water belong to? You say, Yanaka Sandham. Because you kept the pot. But children, I gave you that pot. You have no pot at home. So now whom does that water belong to? You start thinking, right? All political analysis students, especially the Department of Political Science, Gautam, I want you to work on this. You see, my farmer, his land, his efforts, a few multinational corporations would like to invest and say what is to be done. I leave the rest for your imagination. Because according to Gandhiji, India lives in its villages. Let us work on it. And what is the most important word for environment is management. Without the last letter T, it is management. Principal ma'am, please listen to this carefully, Mrs. Kennedy. Management without T is management. And without N, is manage me. Learn to manage yourself. Then we can manage others. That is management. And that is management. You don't require a MBA degree to understand this concept. Is that clear? Very simple way of understanding management. And please try to involve yourself for my country. Every one of us have to contribute something for my country, for our country. Look at this chap who is going over there, happens to see what has fallen down. When a bear can see that it is somebody's job so that they don't meet with an accident. Shall we also get involved? And for all this, we don't require a training. இதுக்கெல்லாம் பயிற்சியே வேண்டாம் ராஜா. What you require is முயற்சி, effort. So put in your effort. This is a simple book which I have developed for science experiments for school children. It has 100 science experiments. So if you have your youngsters and siblings at home, please ask them to go through. Book is not available. It's all online. Everything is for free download. I happened to interact with Professor Kalam about this. And I believe in Tagore for his beautiful statement. With every child that is born comes a message that God is not yet disappointed with man. So let us continue our work. Leave behind a healthy environment for the children who are yet to be born in this world. All for Earth's sake, Bhumi Kaga. That's our eye view, but who cares? All the best, children. Good luck to you all. And thank you. I think I scheduled in time. And thanks very much. The first website, erfindia.org, gives you everything on composting, gives you all the details about all those things which I spoke about. The third one, Simple Task, Great Concepts, gives you those 100 experiments. If you want to see all the videos concerning these things, you can just put Sultani Smile on YouTube. You will get all the information. I take this opportunity to thank my beloved Shankar's IAS Academy. My humble respects to Vaishnavi of Shankar's IAS Academy, Chandru, Chandrasekhar, and all the staff involved from Shankar's Academy who are coordinating today's program. I know that Vijay and other people are coordinating this. To Kumaraguru Institute, the principal herself, for being physically present for this occasion. To Mr. Leo, who has been coordinating since yesterday. Gautam, who has been coordinating since yesterday. And to all the teachers, faculty and students of Kumaraguru and the other institution from Bangalore, Thalassemia, who has also been coordinating with this. And all the participants who have attended today's program. Thank you, children. Good luck. I'll stop sharing so that we interact with each other. Thank you. Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So I'm Vijay, faculty. So some of the doubts are here. So the first doubt is they are expecting you to speak on the impact of environment, which has been completely on the genetically modified seeds instead of a hybrid seed. So they want you to differentiate between a hybrid seed and genetically modified seed. And because of genetically modified seed, what is the impact on the environment?
You see, basically what happens is for those who are from non-science group, in a simple language, if I have to explain to you, a chain of amino acids forms a protein. So this amino acid chain is formed. I am cutting the, and you would have studied even in school, even the non-science students, you have studied in school, one gene, one enzyme hypothesis. So every gene regulates and produces an enzyme. An enzyme is a protein. So when you introduce a foreign gene between a sequence of genes, the type of protein that will be produced will be different from the normal protein that is produced. So this new protein can be allergic not just to human beings, but also to some other organisms which depend on it. Children, please understand that we are not just harvesting the crop. The birds are eating it. The birds are dropping it. Then the soil organisms are eating it. The roots are exuding it. So all this community of ecosystem is operating. Don't view only from the human viewpoint. So when they start consuming it, the soil biodiversity starts moving. The microbial density starts varying itself. So all this total concept can have it on the soil. So any research has to be done in situ, in ecotypes. And that is called as a moratorium, which to a large extent has been overlooked in our country. So what we are trying to tell is keep safe from it and try to concentrate on hybrid is fine because they wanted to grow it, but it will be better if we concentrate on heirloom seeds. Yes, please.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And there is a second question on fuel production. So there is a question by Mr. Venkat. So he says that instead of we depend on importing from, that is oil from Arab countries, why don't we go for indigenous fuel production from the solid waste of household? So what is the scope of it? What would be the future in that? Is there any scope on it?
Any engineering mechanism or any technology which is developed is, the moment I put in something, the output I get should be economically viable and ecologically sustainable. So any product which you use can, from biological waste, can produce biogas, but biodiesel, it is limited because it requires oil seeds. Now these oil seeds can be different thing, or it has to be from different products. So biodiesel has also been attempted through corn, but I am against people who would use a food of another country to produce biodiesel. So in fact, Professor APJ Kalam used to talk about Jatropha. But if you really want to put biodiesel, and if you are an engineering student yourself, instead of asking me that question, I would be appreciate if you can design a project, because Pongamia, Pungamaram, which is very common in our country, North Indian students, it is orange. So if this particular tree produces the nut, and if this is being used in a large quantity, can produce a lot of biodiesel, which can be used into it. Otherwise, you can use bio waste and convert into methane, and methane can be converted into energy.
Okay, sir, thank you. And the third question is regarding the EIA 2020. So we know that already the environment has degraded. Now we are in the process of reconstruction. So what is your opinion? So this EIA, what are the modification has to be there? So what should be done in this EIA? So that's a question by Srinidhi.
No, my particular problem with all this EIA, whatever it is we cannot take environment for granted. And already we have had the problem with my country is we have wonderful regulations, but we fail in implementation. We all know that. In fact, Srinidhi, if you had studied in a CBSE school, because the new education policy is also coming in, I can quote you for you to understand, not for any complaints. In CBSE, you have been given a wide choice that if a child doesn't like a particular subject, you can take any other subject and also pass the examination. But no school in Tamil Nadu, to my extent, North, they are helpful. To my extent, I know a particular school, I know some of the schools in Delhi and Gurgaon, which are doing an excellent job of combinations. I cannot generalize it. To my knowledge, in Chennai, most of the CBSE schools don't allow a child to take any combination other than what the school offers. So implementation, we are failing. So in the new EIA, I can start an industry and then go in for ratification will not be a good step, because there is no point going in for ratification after having polluted the environment. And already with the existing EIA itself, you know what happened in Vishakhapatnam with the stealing, with that stearine being leaked out from a stearine producing company. What has happened in Tuticorin. And most of the places we are aware of, in spite of the regulations. Now, when you liberate those regulations, can lead to a lot of complications.
So there is a question from Karish. Mm-hmm. So now there is a proposal for electronic vehicles policy. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, it will be in the urban areas. So in urban area, the pollution will come down. So how about the rural? And also, there will be a problem of this thermal pollution. So thermal pollution is also, thermal production is also more. So how to counter that? So what is your opinion?
Karish, this is what happens, you know, like out of sight is out of mind. You know, like if you want to really use electric vehicles, you are burning coal somewhere and polluting some part of the place to generate that electricity from which you're going to charge your vehicles. So, you know, like always I tell that no industry can be free of pollution. Can we minimize pollution? This is where I'm trying to talk about. See, even in a kitchen, kitchen is the smallest industry I talk about to my students for understanding the concept. Whatever I do in the kitchen, something is left over which I cannot recycle. Is it clear? Clear, children? So any industry, anything will produce pollution, whether it is your electrical car industry, manufacturing car, even solar energy for that matter. Manufacturing a solar panel is a polluting industry because you use selenium and things like that. So which is less polluting is where we will have to finally compromise on, and how minimal our requirements can become. Like what happened during the pandemic, our requirements went to a minimal. Can we survive with those minimal requirements is what I want you people to think about, children.
Listen, there is one question from Kaushi. So she has written Savu Maram. I think it's so. It is used to protect wind from falling banana trees and all. But her grandfather has told that it will create a lot of heat in the soil. So what is the logic behind it, science behind it, and what is the alternate for it?
If your grandfather has used the word heat, சூடு வெப்பம் அப்படின்னு சொல்லியிருப்பார். தட் இஸ் ஹவ் ஹீ வுட் ஹவ் எக்ஸ்பிளைன். இட் இஸ் பிகாஸ் மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் திஸ் ஹேஸ் மோர் அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் சிலிக்கா இன் இட்ஸ் நீடில் லைக் லீவ்ஸ். இட் ஹேஸ் மோர் சிலிக்கா அண்ட் இட் டசன்ட் டீகம்போஸ் வெரி ஈஸிலி. ஸோ இட் டேக்ஸ் அ லாட் ஆஃப் பேர்டன் த சாயில் டு ஹேப்பன். அண்ட் திஸ் சவுக்கு மரம் விச் யூ டாக் அபவுட் கேஷுரினா, திஸ் கேஷுரினா ஆக்சுவலி இஸ் நாட் யூஸ்ட் அலாங் வித் பனானா, பட் யூ யூஸ் இட் ஆஸ் அ விண்ட் பிரேக்கர். So if you use as a windbreaker, it is only confined to one portion of the field. It doesn't matter if you use it. Only incorporating it completely into the banana plantation can cause some amount of problem. But you can avoid that and you can do it. This thing, you can use it as a windbreaker. There's no problem about it. But I was saying that it's not
true. So there is another question from CB. So he is asking whether do we have any sort of mechanism which records the impact of the impact on the environment by the technologies. As of now, we have
the PCB, the pollution control boards. They are the ones who are doing it. Actually, the central pollution control board is based in Delhi, CPCB. Then you have every state has a pollution control board, and they work in cooperation. They have liberty to go check, report, analyze. They have all those things. In spite of it, things happen. Why I'm trying to tell you this is, I would not blame any particular agency unless every Indian develops a conscience that I should not pollute. I happen to be working with the United Nations Industrial Development Organization on a project, and I happened to visit one of the industrial sectors where I was doing a project for them. So it so happened that every time I would go in their vehicle, which always had that label UNIDO written on the top, and the moment the vehicle would turn into the lane, which was around half a kilometer long, before I would enter the industry portion of the treatment plants were there, the moment the vehicle will turn and we will go there and say, and everything used to work very beautifully. It so happened, I'm telling you long back, about 25 years back, when I drove my own car once because that was not available, there was some problem. I said, no, I have to go for a visit. I had an old Omni with me, Maruti Omni, and I drove my Omni. And they entered the gate. The gate was open because I told that fellow, and he mistook that I belonged to one of the industries from that place. I went inside, I parked the vehicle, nothing was working, and the effluents were directly left into the river. So unless, you know, like we take up that responsibility that as a citizen, I will not pollute. So any amount of legislation, any amount of policy, any amount of thing cannot work till implementation becomes a honest implementation by people.
Thank you, sir. There is another question from Mr. Sandram. So his question on locust. So how locust can be resolved by a common man, a citizen, or a community, and also the country like India? So what is
it? But at the same time, Sangran has said biogenetic threat. It is not biogenetic threat. It is not biogenetic threat. It was a typical locust. It's supposed to be, we have been shown in a movie that a biogenetic thing can come and attack us. It was not a biogenetic. It is a regular phenomenon. It is a regular phenomenon. It happens once in 3-4 years. But what happened was this year, it was too much. Usually Rajasthan will get once in a way, and then they will stop from Rajasthan itself. But this time it moved into Delhi. It also moved till, there were reports into migrating into Maharashtra, Karnataka, and even till Andhra Pradesh. Some of us were even panicked with entering into Nilgiris and other places. It all happens because it's a natural phenomenon. And only thing we can do is to confirm and protect our own biodiversity. What I have been asking some of the startup groups in Chennai, I even spoke to some of them, is there is a report that creating a frequency of sound can chase this locust away. Now, what I was trying to tell them is try to find out whether there is any frequency which will attract them. So if we can create huge tunnels where we can attract them and also store them, catch them, trap them. So create with these sounds, create traps where they can be trapped, and then you process them and convert them into poultry feed. You can be feeding your entire population of birds in this country with the locust feed itself, which you can prepare. So these are all startup ideas which people can work on.
So the sound frequency you are talking about, sir, whether it would affect the other organisms, other birds or other
insects? It has to be worked out, because any sound frequency can disturb any organism. because there are lots of reports about this 5G, if it comes, is going to have a lot of impact on organisms. There are all reports coming up, but there's no concrete evidence so far, but they will be able to generate evidences in the course of time. But it, as far as I told you, no, less harmful. If supposing that frequency of sound is less harmful than using malathion or any of the chemical pesticides which have a longer impact on biodiversity, then you will have to go in for it. That's how we work on in ecology.
Okay, thank you, sir. There is another question from Eugene. So it's about, is there is any possibility of reversal of this groundwater level because of the commercial plantation of like eucalyptus trees and everything? Groundwater level
impact. Eugene, you have asked a very pertinent question. Thanks to you, Eugene, for asking it. Eugene, you should be very clear that there are two types of water levels. One is the subsurface water level and another is the deep water level. The subsurface water level can easily be recharged with your rainwater harvesting if you are doing it properly. We made a blunder by going into deep borewells. That is where the problem happens. Deep borewell recharge takes several years. But every rainfall can recharge our subsurface water level. In the olden days, we used to have these wells, Kenner in Chotramilia, these wells. Wells were all subsurface water, 30 feet, 60 feet, 80 feet. But that can easily be recharged depending upon your soil conditions. There are certain limitations for it. So in case your eucalyptus plantations have a good subsurface area and a gravelly area or a sandy layer beneath it, you can very easily recharge your groundwater and have it remedied. It's not difficult.
Okay, thank you, Professor. And there is another question from Shakila. It's about whether are we going to end up with a problem like this endosulfan Kasaragod tragedy. It's from Texas.
I'm Shakila Banu. What you guess is properly is absolutely true. Any chemical, it may not be similar to Kasaragod. It can be something different also. Anything which is sprayed aerially. Now, what people were saying is for the locust, we will have fire engines and spray them. Now, please understand that these sprays, the molecular size has to be smaller. And a fire engine spray will not be a smaller thing. You have specialized sprayers for it. Without knowing, we think just spray. And that spray will not destroy the target organism, but will have an impact on several non-target organisms. And that can even be human beings, it can be any biodiversity, it can even be the plants through which it can enter into our body, it can go through the food chain, it can go through the food web. What you guess is very true, anywhere it can happen, any organophosphate or organochloride or any of these chemicals can have an impact on anybody else.
There's another question from Mr. John C. So now, because of the lockdown, we have seen some fall in the pollution level, especially in the Ganga River. So whether is it an efficient way to tackle this along with our river cleaning projects?
The fall in level is not because of pollution in the river. The fall in level, the lockdown is the industry has been closed. That means industry was illegally pumping in that water into the Ganges River. Not only Ganges, any of the river systems, because some of the old textbooks on ecology, if you go through them, the ones which I would say is before 1970-71 publications, they would say solution to pollution is dilution. So if you have a pollutant, dissolve it in water, it will get diluted. So unfortunately, we are still trying to follow the same old dictum when the pollution levels have gone higher. That has been there. Taking this as a cue, if the respective state governments take up a policy and the central government decides and takes up a policy that all those polluting agencies which were under lockdown had not polluted, their outlet should be closed until they recycle their water before let out or whatever it is, could be a very good initiative for the whole ecosystem.
Thank you, Professor. Then there's another question from Aditya. So he's asking whether vermicompost and all this biofarming method would be economically feasible for the economically disadvantaged farmer, poor farmers.
Aditya, I'm happy that you asked this question, Aditya. I could not go into the details of it. My compliments to you. Aditya, the thing is what we had in mind. I started my research in 1978-79. And incidentally, 1980-82, we all met together. That is Bernard, Namalwar, I, Vandana Shiva, Claude Alvarez. We all met together in Auroville in those days. And our only decision was how to withdraw a farmer from buying these chemicals from a chemical shop and making the farmer independent, not directing towards an organic shop. I hope I'm clear. Today, people advise, don't buy urea, buy compost. That will not help the farmer. The farmer should follow the LEISA technique, L-E-I-S-A. Please remember, Aditya, L-E-I-S-A, low external input sustainable agriculture. That is, the farmer should be trained to generate some of the inputs in his or her own farm. So something like panchakavya from the cattle, cow dung mixture, the banana waste, using the natural resources and buy minimum from outside, then definitely it will be a very good source of income for the farm.
Thank you, Professor. There is another question. The 3G formula you mentioned to spray, is there is any concentration level to be maintained, or and if it is crossed beyond it, whether it will destroy the crop and what is the impact on the environment?
Abhi, what you ask is very true. If you are from Tamil Nadu, there is a saying, Alavukku meerinal amrudamum nanju. That is, if you exceed the limit, even honey can become a poison. So just because organic doesn't mean that you can spray whatever it is. You just put 3D pest repellents into internet, you will get all the compositions, you can prepare them and then you can use them. That's not a problem at all, but dilution is important. And mostly I tell most my organic farmers is, whenever you prepare anything, don't spray on the whole field. You spray it on one or two plants and see whether the concentration is enough. Otherwise, the leaves will get charred. So there's no point spraying on the whole thing and having them charred. Because, you know, like, for example, chili. Chili, different breeds of chili have different concentrations of karam, kar in it. And different seasons, they may have different concentrations. So it's always better that you prepare, you conduct a small experiment and you do it. In organic farming, every farmer is a scientist. That is the importance of it.
Okay. Thank you, Professor. Then the next question is from Daru. So this is about the Chota Chardam project. So it has have a huge environmental concern. Should the government proceed with the high personal committee's recommendation?
Daruji, this is what the government wants in EIA 2020. It says we don't require a public hearing. We don't need somebody to tell us what we are supposed to do. We don't care who lives around us. We will appoint or nominate a panel of experts. And if the panel of experts tells us it is correct, we will do it. That is why we are trying to talk against EIA 2020. That is the reason we want to tell. That the public and the local people, residents, should be taken into consideration as to what its impact.
Sir, there's a question from Vishnu.
Atmanirbhar, coal industry. Another preview of coal industry. Vishnu, if I may call you by your name itself, Vishnu, you must be aware that they want to have more coal generation plants, especially in Tamil Nadu, between Chennai and Kanyakumari, in several places. And the thing is, coal, when it burns for power generation, it also releases a lot of heavy metals in the air. Even mercury is being released, and it depends on the quality of the coal. And most of the coal was planned to be imported. Luckily, there's a conflict with that country. I don't want to go into those details now. And that coal generates more heavy metals. So when any heavy metal blows from the chimneys and lands up on crop land, there's a possibility of not just using coal, but also eating polluted food in the course of time. Water bodies can also soak in a lot of heavy metals. It can go into the food chain mechanisms as well. So, you know, like what I'm trying to tell you is any industry will produce a pollutant. Are we managing it properly? You know, any industry has to submit a report before starting an industry, how they are going to manage their end products. See, if I am going to peel onion, I am going to have some outer peel out of it. Now, what am I going to do with this outer peel? This is what I ask industries. What are you going to do with it? How safe it is? This is where we will have to concentrate post-COVID at least. Because COVID has taught us that we have to look at the environment with a new perspective. Can we change now? Instead of going backwards and trying to please just one section of society, should we please the environment, which can please everybody else in this world, not just human beings? The problem with both agriculture as well as environment approaches, we have become too anthropocentric. That is, what is good for a human being should be moved towards ecocentric. That is, what will be good for the environment. And second is, in agriculture, can we move from crop-centric? Because every agriculture university has been asked to enhance crop production. That is their duty. So how much of paddy you will produce, how much of wheat you will produce. Instead, can we start thinking about farmer-centric? How better we can create a farmer who will produce the crop? How can we provide farmer with a good health benefit, good schools for his children, good entertainment for his children? His area can we develop and generate employment for children coming from that area and make that rural environment competitive enough to live by themselves? That only then we can improve ourselves.
Okay, sir. So there is another question by Kaushi. So why there is no proper waste management system in our environment?
Kaushi, it starts from home. I told you management, manage me. See, in my house, I recycle all my food waste. I recycle my washroom water and my laundry water. I do all the rainwater harvesting. I'm trying to do it in my limited space itself. I don't have a big space with me, but I'm doing it in my limited space. Unless each one of us try to handle things, there's no point blaming the government for it. Human participation, public participation is essential. Can I start with something? That is where I'm asking you people. Nothing else, children. If each one of us start thinking, can I do something, we can achieve children.
Thank you, Professor. There's another question from Athiria. So will someone from okay, so you discuss about the XY chromosome.
XY chromosome. We will see to it that some stud bulls are maintained. Our selected bulls alone will be maintained, which will definitely, if you are a science student, you will understand that what is the concept of a gene pool and how a gene pool can get affected. Because the production of milk does not depend just on the genes of the cow, but also from the genes of a bull. So gradual dilution may take place in the course of time. That is where our plannings can go wrong.
Thank you, Professor. So there is another question from Shahru. So he says that drip and sprinkle irrigation system and biofertilizers are sufficient to enhance our agro-based industry for our economic deal. So because India is mainly an agro-based industry, he's asking question, I think so, whether this is sufficient. Irrigation system, drip irrigation system and biofertilizers.
No, I don't want to talk about any particular system. I want to talk about natural conservation. You see, if you want to have a soil and you want to have a plastic mulch on it, naturally it will generate heat inside. So naturally you would like to have drip irrigation along with it. Now, in case you are using mulch, mulch can protect soil, will protect moisture, will provide carbon, will provide organic matter, and my soil will have a holistic development. So unless we try to think about a small and a marginal farmer, we won't be able to grow our agriculture. Most of you children, you get carried away with the big agricultural farms which are there. It is not so. India lives in its small farms which are decentralized. And these are the farms. And especially with today's economic conditions in India, agriculture will be the savior for our country and not the bigger industries, because we are going through a problem. So we have to rethink about agriculture. We have to rethink our inputs and we have to rethink about a lot of things. Most of these complications come from agricultural loans. Because in agricultural loans, the farmer is made to go and take a loan. Loan is not money. Unfortunately, if the government gives money, they will buy whatever they want. But the loan comes in the form of chemical fertilizer, chemical pesticide, seeds from the company, and little bit of money. That is where the problem starts. The farmer has no choice to choose that I will take an organic loan. The farmer has to take a loan. So lots of changes have to come at the policy level. And you children, once you become officers, you will do it. I hope so, and I'm confident. Yeah.
Sir, so almost we have done our questions, sir.
Thank you, Pa. Thank you, Chandru.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, wonderful session, sir.
Thank you, Raja. Thank you, Pa. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
I think we have a lot of
Saranna. Yes. Saranna,
yes, sir. Everyone present here. This is Saran studying second year BA Political Science in Kumar Guru College of Liberal Arts and Science. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Sultan Albert Ismail. Sir, thank you. Thank you so much for taking out your time from your schedule for us and educating the young aspirants. Your words on the importance of biodiversity and sustainability was of great impact on all of us. Thank you again, sir. Secondly, I would like to thank the moderator of the session for a very smooth working throughout. I would like to thank Kumar Guru Institutions and Kumar Guru College of Liberal Arts and Science for organizing this webinar for the betterment of civil service aspirants. Next, I would like to thank Sankar IAS Academy, who have been the backbone of the whole program. And next, I would like to thank our knowledge partner, Takshashila Institutions, for their support. Last but not the least, I thank all the participants and welcome you to join this evening at 5 p.m. for the session on the topic Career in Civil Service by Mr. Kirti Vasan, IAS. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you
to everyone.
Holds its core values integral to the culture of learning and innovation.
We offer one of the best teaching team in the country, world-class infrastructure and digital classrooms for our students.
I have seen students come in with a dream in their eyes and go out as bureaucrats.
Our academy serves as a platform for students to become future IAS, IPS, IRS officers and also to face the challenges of life ahead.
We help you fulfill that dream of the civil services.
Your aspirations and dreams finally become a reality.